Yankees back home after that 10-game roadie out west in which they went 6-4. They have six ball games, three against Arizona, day off on Thursday, and then the New York Mets and that very talented pitching staff will be here on the weekend. Rockies, as we were discussing, 5-1 against Arizona so far this year. But both of those series came at Chase Field. Tyler Chatwood taking the Coors Field mound. 2-0 this year against the Diamondbacks. Always good to be back home. And hopefully most of the dark weather is moving out, though I know the next couple of days could be sketchy. Tuesday night and a Wednesday afternoon affair. Gene Segura has been the best offensive player for Arizona this year in his first year in the desert. And here's Chip Hale's lineup presented by Southwest Airlines. It will feature Brandon Drury, a tough out. He'll bat second. Paul Goldschmidt, don't be deceived by that average. We all know he's one of the best players in the game. He's on base more than 40% of the time. He's going to break out. You just hope it's not over the next 3 days. Jake Lamb will bat fourth. Wellington Castillo's hit 7 home runs from behind the plate. Chris Herman was behind the plate yesterday. He hit a pair of home runs. He gets a start in right field. Chris Owings is in center. Nick Ahmed is at shortstop batting eighth. And then Archie Bradley just called up earlier this afternoon to make his second start of the year, is on the mound. Chatwood's numbers, as Jeff was telling you, very, very good, particularly and obviously out on the road.
4-0 with a .33 ERA, but that translates to a .215 overall, and that's good for eighth best in the National League. And you mentioned it, Drew, a moment ago. Against Arizona, he's 2-0 with the .71. So for Tyler, he doesn't need to change anything, because what he did was just flat out dominating against Arizona. He worked his fastball down in the count, or down in the zone, got ahead in the count all day long when he needed to, also got some double play ground outs. But Tyler, just continue to use that same game plan. Don't change it up.
First pitch misses, ball one. And Chatwood has pounded the zone, and that's one of the most important elements. Only 8 walks so far this year. And the minute I say that, he probably falls behind Segura 2-0.
That's part of the success of any pitcher, is working ahead in the count. Doesn't matter who you are, how long you played in the league.
This ball is well hit left center field, and Parr is going to have to play chase in one of the deepest portions of the ballpark. And they'll hold him to a double. So Gene Segura continues to hit, and that 2-0 pitch was an elevated fastball.
Well, and Gene Segura just continues to hit this year. I mean, he started from opening day and had one of the most hits in April for the Diamondbacks in their history, and then he laces this double to left field. 50 times on base batting out of the leadoff spot for Gene Segura.
You see Dexter's been on 60 times for the Cubs. What a remarkable start they're off to. And Fowler has had a gorgeous first 6 weeks of the season. Brandon Drury takes ball one. This kid, one of the top prospects the last couple of years in the Diamondback chain. He's played all over, third, second. And he's in the outfield tonight. He's in left field.
That's because he's hitting.
Play hitter well, you're going to find a spot. This is slowly hit to third, and did they get the out?
Dropped the baseball.
The ball got dropped. That was a really weird play, because Segura saw the softly hit ball and he tried to cross over. Nolan recognized that. He was just finding somebody to get to the bag.
Because he had Trevor coming behind him and he had Tyler going in front of him. And then it was a foot race to the bag between Segura and Tyler. So Nolan comes and gets it, realizes he can't tag him, made the flip to Tyler. You'll see on the Subaru Supermo, he just dropped it in his haste to apply the tag.
And now you got a situation, first and third, nobody out. And here's Goldschmidt, who's just one for his last 18, but think you pitch him any differently. This guy is a tough out, and he will not swing at pitches out of the zone. He gets a pitch up, and Cargo trying to get behind the baseball, and here's the throw to the plate, and just a little bit late, and that will produce a run. So Goldschmidt drives in his 17th run, a sack fly, and it's 1-0 Arizona. Let's take a look at the Rockies defense while we have a moment. Jake Lamb's coming up. Para Blackman and Gonzalez. Arenado, Story, LeMahieu, Mark Reynolds starting at first base. Paulson started yesterday at first. In the finale in San Francisco, Tony Walters is behind the plate. When Tony starts, the Rockies are 9-4 this year. That's a good look at Tony, and he's caught Chatwood. They're going to appeal to third. Can't hurt. Did he leave early? Evidently not.
He just looked awkward at third because of the way he took off from the bag. He had his back to the outfield. He was tagging up with the wrong foot. So that's why they went ahead and threw over to first, or third, excuse me.
Rockies have three on the right side, the fastball on the inside corner for a strike. Talking about Walters catching Chatwood. The two starts where Tyler didn't give up a run, Walters was behind the plate.
Sometimes you just have a feel with a catcher. You're on the same page, whatever cliche you want to work or use.
Is this hit hard enough for two? Should be. There's one on the first. Double play. 4-5-3 on the turn. Rockies do give up a run as Gene Segura led off with a double. So it's 1-0 Diamondbacks. Charlie Blackman getting ready to go. Charlie was activated in time for the first game of the Arizona series on the road trip, and he had a really solid trip altogether, including his first home run of the year. Here's the Southwest batting order tonight for Walt. Trevor Story will bat second. Cargo in that three spot at 312. Nolan up to 322. He had three more hits yesterday. Gerardo Parra, the former Diamondback, will bat fifth. Then Mark Reynolds, another former Arizona player. DJ LeMahieu, over 300 as well. Tony Walters and Tyler Chatwood. You're used to seeing solid averages, 300 plus averages. You look at Archie Bradley for the Rockies. What is interesting is these averages, here we are in almost mid-May, have been built on the road by and large, not inflated by Coors Field.
Really?
Yes.
It can happen then, is what you're saying.
It can.
Okay.
So Archie Bradley, hard throwing right-handers, first pitch is in there for a strike at 94. Again, called up earlier today because Arizona's in a strange stretch, man. Talk about busy. They're playing 36 games in 37 days, and that's going to be a base hit. Get down. Yep, we will. For a moment, I thought it was going to hang long enough for Chris Herrmann. But they're in such a difficult stretch where they're playing every day that Chip Hale said, I want to stretch out my rotation a little bit, give everybody an extra day off to catch their breath. And that's why they brought Archie Bradley up. Ruby De La Rosa, it was scheduled on 4 days rest, normal rest, to pitch today. they pushed him to tomorrow, and Bradley will make this spot start.
Well, if you remember when the Rockies were down in Arizona a week ago on that Sunday, that was the end of 20 straight for them. They had the Monday off before they headed to Miami, and now again another 16 straight. So Archie Bradley is the guy. They wanted to call him up yesterday. They just couldn't get it done in time, so that's why he's starting today.
So here's Story, and he takes a strike. Trevor has worn out the Arizona Diamondbacks. Five of his 11 home runs have come down at Chase Field at the D-backs' expense. Showing the outfield, they're going to play really deep because you have three infielders playing the outfield right now. Chris Owings played a lot of center field this year. Last year, he played 115 at second, and he had 20-plus starts at shortstop. He's a tremendous athlete. He's been solid in center. Brandon Drury's a third baseman. He's in left field, and Chris Herman's a catcher. He's out in right. And this ball toward the gap in right center field. Charlie is going to get a green light from Stu Cole. Story will stop at second, and the Rockies have tied it up, two hitters in. Trevor Story with his 25th RBI. Back even and quickly.
And that's how you answer a run in the top half of the inning. You come right back, get a leadoff single by Charlie Blackman, and then this double to right field that he stayed on in the Subaru Supermo. Archie Bradley tried to flip a curveball over the plate, didn't work. Charlie just hustling the whole way around second, not even glancing. He knows that he's going to be able to score easily.
So here's Carlos Gonzalez with a great opportunity to give the Rockies the lead, or at the very least move Story to third with nobody out. Cargo's gone 12 games without driving in a run. He is getting his hits. And I said this yesterday on the air. He's coming in hitting 312, and by his standards, scuffling, but he's getting hit. So just wait till he gets hot.
He's also scored 21 runs, which is third on the Rockies. Nolan's first, Trevor's second. So he's doing his part. And like you say, once he starts to get it, then those home runs and RBIs are just going to start piling on.
Well, we all know this to be true. He's one of those guys, one of those rare guys, just a handful in the game. He can go hit 6-7 home runs in a week and drive in, you know, 15 in a week. 1-1. Cargo in his last at bat yesterday against the Giants, Huey. I mean, did he ever hit a one iron to center field?
That was kind of a hacked off swing. That he had missed a couple fastballs, and he just lined that one to Blanco in center field, and he was just playing so deep he caught it.
Yeah. You know, Cargo's stretch of 12 games without an RBI is the second longest of his career. The only one longer was 14 games, and that was back in 08 when he was a puppy with the Oakland A's. When
just
he was truly
learning.
When he was truly a little pony. Well, last year Archie Bradley got a start in April against the Rockies, and this was a scary moment. I mean, that was one of the scariest things I've ever seen on a baseball field. He had a broken sinus. That ball came off the bat at 115 miles an hour, and Archie, as you see, walked off. And thankfully, after I couldn't believe it, it was a short stint on the DL, and he came back. And
you don't know if there was a correlation between that, but when he came back after that, he was 0-3 with a 10.90 ERA.
I don't know how there can't be, right?
Exactly. I mean, you, as an athlete, you don't want to say that's why it was. But still, it had to play mind games with you when you're standing on the hill.
1-2, and Cargo is on that fastball at 95. And I mean, it has to, it's that guy again. It's got to run through your mind right now a little bit, doesn't it?
Well, they faced each other one time in spring training early, just one at bat. It was one pitch. It was over with. But so it didn't have the same feel as a major league game. So it's got to be there somewhere in the recesses.
Downstairs. Two balls, two strikes on Cargo. I know Cargo. America is really excited about this club, as is everybody. And that clubhouse is tight knit. They pitched.
Well, to come off that road trip 6-4, when you feel like you left a couple games out there where you could have come home 8-2.
Yeah, absolutely. Rockies have lost 5 one-run games this year, just 1-5. And remember how miserable it felt when they took off on the road trip. They've lost 5 straight games at Coors Field.
Right. Then they go down to Arizona and sweep them.
Yeah. Story at second. Nolan Arenado is on deck. We're in a 1-1 game in the bottom of the first, nobody out.
It's nice to be playing back at home again.
Yeah, it's been a while. Put a pick play on, and that goes into center field. That's a good read by Trevor with help from Stu Cole, because it looked like the ball was tracking towards center, but kind of got slowed down and Segura ran over there.
Those are the hard read after you slid back into the bag. See how your head's turned, and then for a moment you lose track of the ball. Where is it? And then by the time you pick it up again, you take the 2 or 3 strides. And then he did look at Stu. Stu had his hands up, said, no, 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 don't go.
And that's a strikeout. Foul tip held. One out. And that'll bring up Arenado. Here's our Mako big hit. And it was Nolan's triple yesterday. Nolan doesn't collect a lot of triples, but if you hit it that far out in Triples Alley at AT&T, you'll get your fair share. So that's our Mako big hit of the series. Single, double, triple yesterday for Nolan. Outside. A more patient Nolan Arenado. This year, I mean, listen, he's never going to be confused with, you know, Paul Goldschmidt, who sees more pitches than anybody. But Nolan's being a little more selective. We know he's walking more, and the swings and misses are down. Takes a strike there.
He's taking more first pitches, down 5%. Swings and misses are down almost 5%. Walks are up. But that happens when you have the confidence at the plate. Doesn't matter what they're going to throw you. If they're going to throw you away, you'll hit it away. If they throw you in, you'll take them out. 2 strikes behind in the count. All of that's working in Nolan's favor.
And another called strike. Some borderline pitches, but good pitches from Archie Bradley's standpoint. And Vic Carapazza behind home plate. Pumped his right arm a couple times. So now Nolan in a ditch 1-2, but that hasn't been a problem, because when he's behind in the count, he's hitting 355 this year, which is absurd.
The major league average is 191. That tells you how good it is. The national league average is 190.
With 2 strikes, he's hitting 310.
That's what I'm saying. That's why you can take more pitches. He's okay. Not going to change my approach.
Chris Owings just walked from right center field 10 paces toward left center. Nolan with the quick hands fouls that pitch off. Bradley is predominantly a fastball, curveball guy. He's got a big arm. In fact, 2 years ago, he was the number one pitching prospect in the game, not just in the Diamondbacks chain, in the game.
First round pick in 2011, 7th overall. That was the year Garrett Cole was taken number 1. 5 of the top 7 picks that year were pitchers.
Do you see him playing long toss before the game?
Oh, that's ridiculous.
Well, that's not long toss. That's ridiculous toss.
I mean, reminds me of Jose Mesa, what he used to do when he was here, how long they would play catch. Trevor Bauer was one of those guys that they would just stretch it out for 300 plus feet.
He would throw from that third base line, folks, all the way to the warning track with his throwing partner. He's throwing it well over 300 feet. 3-2. And if he wanted to, I know he could throw it into the bullpen.
Just have to put a little more arc on it.
Yeah, it wasn't, and that's right, yeah. He wasn't throwing fly balls.
No, no, it was more on the line.
Story at second. 3-2 on Nolan.
Tried to pick that time with Segura.
Yeah, I mean, they're trying to keep him close, but Huey, as deep as the outfield is,
not gonna matter.
It's not going to matter, especially as well as Trevor runs on a base hit.
And as you mentioned, with the three infielders playing outfield.
And another, ooh,
he dropped
foul
it.
Tip, he dropped it. That's going to keep Nolan at the plate. Catches a break. And what Chip Hale's trying to argue, I'm sure, is that it was on the exchange, and he's going to get the umpires together. He's going to say, no, he caught the foul tip, but when he reached in his glove, that's when it came out.
As all Vic saw was the ball hit the ground.
You know what? They have
a
case.
He's right.
Yep, they got a case.
But he still has it in his glove.
Yeah, it's on transition. Yep. Two outs.
But they did the right thing getting together, because Vic could not see it where he was positioned behind the hitter. He got help from John Hirschbeck, the crew chief.
Well, Archie Bradley producing strikeouts is not unusual. He's leading the PCL right now. You look at this again in strikeouts per inning pitched. He's got a big arm.
Always has.
So it'll be left to Gerardo Parra. Parra had a nice road trip, drove in 8 runs in 10 ball games.
That helped the average with runners in scoring position at 361, 13 for 36 on the season.
Rockies have been good producing 2-out runs. That's what they did yesterday. This is slowly hit, and Goldschmidt, is he on the bag? He is. Otherwise, Story would have scored. He may have rolled his ankle making that play. So the Rockies get a single from Blackman and a double from Story to even the count at 1. As we go to inning number 2 at Coors Field.
Behind me, you can see he's getting ready for this second inning. The good thing about him is he works fast, and Charlie Blackman's a fan of that.
He has a really fast tempo, and he's very aggressive. So he's not a guy that goes out there and nibbles and falls behind in the count and gives guys free bases. And that, you know, that's not going to happen. I mean, you're either going to have to get a hit like pretty quickly, or you're going to make an out. And either way, like, the defense is involved, so I enjoy playing behind him.
And Drew and Jeff, we've heard it over and over this season. They love playing behind him, the infielders and outfielders, because of that tempo.
Well, you have a couple guys, actually several now on that staff. There's a base hit up the middle by Willington Castillo. Bettis works very quickly. Chatwood works quickly. John Graves worked with good tempo. Eddie Butler yesterday worked with good tempo.
It just keeps you involved mentally in the game. And then because you're mentally involved, you'll also be physically involved. It helps everybody. And that's one thing, if you're trying to teach young kids, young pitchers, try to teach them that faster tempo if you can, because that just keeps the game moving along.
So Tyler's given up a couple hits already, a couple hard hit balls, a Segura double, and that sharp single there by Willington Castillo. Chris Herman, the hero for the Diamondbacks yesterday. They won 5-3 and 11 against Atlanta. And he hit two home runs, including a two-run home run in the 11th to provide them with their margin of victory. What was very interesting about the two home runs, first time he's had a multi-home run game in his career, is that both home runs came on 0-2 pitches. That had not happened in the same game for the same guy since 2000, when Lance Berkman
did it
against the Royals.
But yesterday, Chris Herman hooks one around the pole, or right off the pole in right field, and then just for good measure, right center field.
Yeah, let me correct one. I said 2009, Berkman did it against the Royals. 2-1, and now it's 2-2. So Herman's got four home runs as the backup catcher. Willington Castillo, who's at first, has seven bombs, kind of picking up where he left off last year. So between the two of them, 11 home runs, leads all of baseball when it comes to a catching tandem. Just inside. Two ground ball, could be two. Tough to turn this one, and they'll get just one. It's a good play by DJ to make sure that he got the leading man. I think a lot of second basemen there say, you know what, the heck with it, I'll just take the easy out at first.
But he knew that Castillo was running, the catcher, a little slower, and also this ball beats the runner. So that's also your other indication that I can make that play going back to second base. Now, if Castillo had beaten the ball and it went behind him, then DJ would have just got the out at first. The other good thing that he did too, and it's really hard most of the time with young infielders, is they try to make everything happen too fast. He caught the ball first and then made the strong throw.
Chris Owings fouls us off. Now, Chris has seen the ball well against Chatwood. He's one of the few guys in that Diamondback lineup that's had success against him. He has four hits and seven at bats, including three doubles against Chatwood. One top of two, one out. Herman at first, and Owens, who could fly, is at the plate.
Tough guy to double up. We saw a play in Arizona where he had just a two hopper. The DJ still wasn't able to turn that. That's how quickly you can get down the line, even from the right side of the box.
It's one of those ones where you're almost startled.
Like, what? Wow, he's already there.
Got down the line. Two strikes. Chatty throws that fastball more 71% of the time. Misses away at 94. Orange County in Southern California. the Redlands area. Redlands area is a neat part of SoCal because you are less than an hour from Palm Springs in the desert, and you're less than an hour up in the mountains to go skiing in Big Bear.
So what do? You golf, or maybe like what we can do here? You go ski in the morning, golf in the afternoon.
You absolutely could do that there, and if you really hustle, you can get to the beach too.
First nice sunset.
Yep. This is in the air to Carr going right. Two gone. Nick Ahmed coming up. Let's take a look at our Office Liquidator Series storylines as the Rockies return home. Home field advantage, well, it hasn't been so far. Traditionally, it is. Rockies just 4-8. Rockies, as we talked about, have dominated the Diamondbacks thus far this year. And Cargo has beaten up his former club. There's Carlos. There's a happy flight home last night. Good pitch.
Bad guessing fastball.
Nick went just 1-for-11 in that Atlanta series. He gets fisted there and he fouls it off. So the Rockies swept Arizona and then continued on to San Diego, and then Arizona left for that road trip. And it began in Miami, and it kind of went the way things went at home for Chip Hale's club. They got swept by the Marlins. Then they went to Atlanta, and Atlanta's just miserable. They've got one win at home and they swept the Braves. Here's the 0-2. 1-2.
Yeah, 1-15 for Atlanta at home.
Have you ever heard anything like that?
I haven't. I'm trying to think back to when somebody was that bad at home, and it'd have to go back a long ways. Can't remember any in my lifetime.
Two and two. The last really, really, really bad team that I recall that stands out. I mean, there's been some teams that have lost 100 games over the last 15 years, but you remember that Tiger team, Huey, about, I don't know, 10, 12, 13 years. I think Alan Trammell was manager. They lost 119 games, something like that. They had to win like two or three at the end to avoid 120 losses.
The Braves are on pace for over 130 losses.
3-2 now on Ahmed. So Chris Herman at first will be moving. Well, you want to get this guy right now and have the luxury of facing Archie Bradley to lead off the third inning. Dougie did a little research. The worst Braves season ever when they were in Boston in 1935. They went 38-115. The worst team since 1900. The 1916 Philadelphia A's, 36-117. They wouldn't even show up for the bobblehead days back then.
They had bobblehead days then?
Well, if they did.
If they did.
Nick Ahmed from the University of Connecticut. Big congratulations to Kyle Hewson, graduated from UConn yesterday.
Well, like a lot of people now, I mean, graduations are happening, so just proud of everybody that's graduating.
All right, a DJ, and that'll end the inning. So there was a hit, no other damage. We'll go to the bottom of the second. The Rockies won, and the Arizona Diamondbacks won. Good Sports is brought to you by your hometown Toyota stores. Toyota, let's go places. And by Southwest Airlines, transparency, low fares, nothing to hide. With Jeff Houston and Mark Stout, I'm Drew Goodman. The Rockies on a six-game homestand, three against the Diamondbacks, and then on the weekend, the Mets are in town. Rockies got a run in the first, single by Charlie Blackmon, double to the right center field gap by Trevor Story. Here's Mark Reynolds. Mark's been terrific so far in a Rockies uniform. 333 average, couple home runs, driven in 11, hitting 385 since April the 12th, which is the third best batting average of guys that have at least 50 at bats in the big leagues during that period of time. Martin Prado and Ryan Braun better. Let it out, Danielle. That's okay. Here's the 0-2.
There's nothing wrong with letting the neighbors know you're cheering.
Nope. See, to me, those two pitches, we talk about this a lot, Hugh. You're at the plate, you're in an 0-2 ditch, and I mean, you've been in that situation a bunch, and then all of a sudden, I mean, you don't even have a decision to make. Two pitches, not even close. Now you're back in it. You can roll your neck a little bit. You go, okay, it's on now.
And more relaxed at the plate then, no doubt about it.
Now it's 3-2.
And it adds pitches to a pitch count. So instead of being able to last longer in the game, you're out of there in the sometimes fourth or fifth inning because of 0-2 back to 3-2 and maybe a foul tip, foul ball. Not this time.
Herman makes the catch. That'll bring up LeMahieu. If the Rockies score seven or more runs, go to participating Colorado Taco Bell locations the following day. Make sure you do it between 4 and 6 to receive your Rockies Taco Special. Live Boss at Taco Bell. So DJ's got the average 1 point better than last year. 301 last year. He's at 302 right now. As steady as they come. DJ looks at strike one. The big right hander, Bradley's 6'4 and about 225.
Just 23 years of age for Archie Bradley.
Same high school as Brad Penny, Broken Arrow High School in Broken Arrow, Oklahoma, suburb of Tulsa. Inside.
Committed to play football and baseball at OU. I'll go ahead and play baseball and also try to be a quarterback on the football team.
Yeah, special athlete. I don't think throwing the deep ball was probably an issue for Archie.
Might be the short passes that go through the receiver's hands because he's throwing it so hard.
Remember when Elway came up, that was the problem. He was breaking guys' webbings on their fingers. He had such a howitzer. 3-1. And this is on the ground, second. Two outs. That'll bring up Tony Walters. Tony getting an opportunity again with the injury to Nick Hundley to catch the bulk of the games. Nick was on the 7-day concussion DL a couple weeks ago and he was out for about 10 days. And this is on the ground to short and it comes up on Ahmed and he's not going to come close to get Walters, who's Tony runs really well. That's a rarity. Nick Ahmed, one of the top shortstops defensively in the game. Looked like the ball came up late on him.
fourth error of the season for Nick, and he also drops down to a knee, which is unusual for a shortstop. You'll see it at second base, but not a shortstop, because you know you have to get rid of the ball quickly, and that ball just played him on the Subaru Supermo. Tried to catch it too close to his body instead of having his hands out in front.
So here's Chatwood. There's a strike on Tyler. It's that time of night at Coors Field. That sun is really tough on first baseman. A lot of times, remember, guys on the left side when Todd was out there, they bounce it across on purpose this time of night. This is going to be a tough play, and no play for Segura. And Chatwood reaches. I'm sure that'll be a hit. Chip Hale looking out there saying, boy, this inning was cruising, and now Charlie Blackman's coming up with traffic.
Gene Segura bobbled the ball that DJ had hit. Didn't get down, went off the front part of his glove. Now, this was a tougher play because it had English on it, and he's moving to his left, but he still didn't get the glove down onto the ground.
Make him pay, right?
That's right. That's the 21st error. I'm talking about with the Mets error. I think they've ruled this one a base hit. They haven't ruled yet, but how far he had to go. See how his glove, that just popped out. I thought he didn't have his glove down far enough. Better shot on the Subaru Supermo, and it is a hit for Tyler, his third one this season.
So here's Charlie, rifled a single to right his first time up. Keep bringing up this outfield, see if it comes into play that you have two guys who are not real experienced in a cavernous outfield, the biggest outfield in baseball, in Herman in right, Drury in left. Charlie getting locked in. Remember earlier in the year, Charlie was having good ABs, but didn't have a lot to show for it. The average was below 200. He's hitting seven straight now.
And I think back to that series in Arizona for the opening weekend, how many balls he hit hard in that series and came out about hitting a buck and some change.
Two balls and a strike. See a pattern. Bradley trying to stay away from Blackman. Good speed at second. And Chatwood's an athlete at first. I mean, you don't want him trying to really spin his tires, but Tyler can run fine. Just remember when Tyler pulled his hamstring running the bases.
That's the last outing of spring training two or three years ago, trying to leg out a triple over in Peoria against the Mariners.
Well, you got a good memory. That's outside now. It's 3-1.
And it was a night game.
You're the best. Got a memory like a steel trap.
That's right. Just ask Dougie.
Or like an elephant, though. I don't know who did the research, and we know that elephants have great memories.
I know.
This ball's lifted foul and out of play to left.
Now you definitely have the advantage with Tyler running as the trail runner.
Trevor Story hoping for an opportunity, drove in the Rockies run in the first with a double to right center. Two outs, two on. And they'll be moving. Ball four. So here comes Story. The Diamondback killer, with all of a sudden the bases drunk. Crowd of buzz as Trevor Story walks up. Well, against the Diamondbacks, five of his eight hits have gone over the fence. And he's thrown in a triple and a double. So he's got one single. 12 of his 25 RBIs against Arizona.
Yeah, but when you're hitting the ball that hard and that far, who needs a single? I'll take all the extra base hits, the slugging percentage. For a guy that was just named the starting shortstop 5 or 6 days prior to that first game in Arizona, he has just taken that position and put a lock on it and said, it's mine.
The thing I like about Trevor, I like a lot of things about Trevor. First of all,
yeah,
he's great.
Where do you want to start?
Yeah, first of all, he's a great kid. But he's even keel. I mean, you know, there's natural tendency here to get over anxious, bases loaded. But he stays within himself. He's 1 for 2 this year with the bases loaded. He had a bases clearing double earlier this year. Walters reached on an error with two outs. Tyler had an infield hit. Charlie just walked. There's the threesome on base in a 1-1 ball game, bottom of two. A big take in that it was a close pitch, but it was off the plate. So instead of 0-2, it goes to 1-1.
That's what's great about looking at the Subaru strike zone, because the way Wellington Castile caught that ball, it gave the appearance that it was a strike. It wasn't. He just said, nope, make sure I lay off of that.
And here's the 1-1. Good cut. As of yet, Huey, we haven't seen a good secondary pitch from Archie Bradley.
The one he threw earlier in the game to Trevor was bad, that curveball. He scrapped that. He said, nope, I'm not throwing that. Threw a couple changeups to Charlie. That didn't work. Sliders. So now you sit there and say, I'm looking just dead red. Throw me the 94-mile-an-hour fastball. I don't trust you can throw an off-speed breaking pitch right now.
1-2. And he went changeup, and it's low. Guys are doing their homework. I mean, when you see guys on the top step of the dugout sitting, I mean, they're studying right now. This is where your homework's done for your next AB.
You do all the film work before the game, during the game. You keep your eyeballs on them and say, this is what I'm seeing, so I know what I look for when I go to the plate.
This ball driven deep to right, but it's going to fade into the stands. The wind really pushed it. Foul off the bat. It was fair territory for a little bit. And ended up well fouled.
Yeah, and that's the way the wind's blowing in from left field, the cross. Kind of from left field over to the right field corner.
Already 46 pitches for Archie Bradley.
Well, how many more in this inning because of the air to Tony Walters?
Strike three called on the inside corner.
That's
and
not
that
a strike.
Was in.
Not even close on the Subaru strike zone.
No. That's a tough break. So the Rockies leave them loaded in the second, 1-1. set the bases loaded. A tough called third strike on Trevor Story. Rockies fans join in on the conversation all year long. Send us your thoughts, photos, questions. Make sure you use your favorite social media platform and include the hashtag Toyota Talk. Tyler Chatwood will face Archie Bradley, and then the top of the order in the top of the third for the Diamondbacks. Diamondbacks, Huey, a lot like the Rockies. They've been good on the road, struggling at home.
Yeah, for Arizona, 5-12 at home, 10-6 on the road. Well, you and I were talking a little bit with Chip Hale before the game, and he was talking about the home record, but he was more in the making the statement or case that it was the teams that they had played.
And you know what? He had high praise, effusive, in fact, in his praise of the Colorado Rockies. And it's not just the five victories, six ball games during the regular season. Chip was telling us, said, I could tell very early in spring training with the defense the Rockies play and some of the arms he was seeing, he said, this is not going to be, you know, right, a fluky or maybe a Rockies team we've witnessed from the last few years that can hit, feel, but, you know, the pitching is suspect. He saw it coming in spring training.
And it was really unsolicited. We weren't asking. He just said, hey, I've seen this. I've seen what's happened. And, I mean, that's the kind of praise you want to hear if you're sitting in the other dugout.
Sure.
That healthy respect for anybody.
Segura fouls it off the very end of his bat, 1-1. But, you know, you and I have heard it so many times in the past that great respect for the Rockies lineup, because year in and year out, not mm-hmm. just at Coors Field, but, you know, the Rockies have some of the top position players in the game. But we all know that this sport is about pitching, and the Rockies the last several years have struggled in that department. But now you're talking about the maturation that we've seen with John Gray, Eddie Butler.
Well,
you know, Tyler Chatwood back. I mean, look how good he's been. Chad Bettis emerging. This is chopped to short. Segura can run, and a good throw. Staying behind that throw by Trevor Story, two outs.
But it was also before he got to the ball, the footwork for Trevor before. Just watch his feet and how they set up for this throw before he fields the baseball. Okay, chopper. Now he's gathering himself right there, so when he catches it, it's just a shuffle and let go of the ball.
So two outs, nobody on, and Brandon Drury's at the plate. He reached on a fielder's choice his first time. That pitch is up. Drury the last 3 weeks hitting 353, including five home runs. You know, and some of that praise also just from Chip Hale. Yesterday after the ball game, Bruce Bochy, in his summation of not only yesterday's game but the series, he said, listen, we faced two really good pitchers the last couple days. He said fastballs in the mid 90s at the bottom of the zone, and then sliders from 86 to 89.
Well, and with movement on those two seam fastballs by John Gray, throwing 95, 96 mile an hour with looked like hard sliders. That's how they were going. And then Eddie following it up with six innings of great performance for him. So two of the best outings that those guys have had.
And Chatwood, a low throw. Why can't pitchers throw to first?
I have no idea. They work on it all the time.
1-2-3 third for Chatwood.
Gonzalez is going to lead off. He's talking to Cargo about 2010 when he always says, oh, that's when I was good compared to this year. And I looked at his numbers through 30 games. He's only missed one game. That was that Friday night game in Arizona. Hits almost the same, 39 and 41. Home runs the same, average a little bit less. But remember, that was the year he had 197 knocks on the year and hit 336. Not that far off, Drew and Jeff, for his start.
No, and Cargo finished, what, third in the MVP voting that year? He gets under this one, the deep center field. Did he get enough of it? Not quite. Owens is going to make the catch in the middle of the track. Cargo is going to hit, and he's going to hit for power. He is in a really good place. And as I said earlier, if this is a period that he is, quote unquote, struggling, and on the road trip he hit 330, still pretty good place to be.
A lot of guys would like to be in that spot that Cargo's in. The one guy that's kind of on a planet and island with few others is this guy at the plate.
And Archie Bradley may get ambushed right here after that first at bat by Nolan. Now he takes a strike. I thought he may change up the approach as he took a couple of strikes his first at bat. One ball, one strike. Nolan second in the league in OPS at 1083. Leads in a number of categories. It's fouled off. And you know what category he leads in right now? According to Stats Inc., wins above replacement, WAR, and every baseball club and Baseball Reference, Fangraphs, they all have their ways of calculating WAR, but right now the number one player in baseball, according to WAR, wins above replacement, Nolan, in front of Manny Machado. So what that says, folks, is that according to Stats Inc. And how they value offense and defense, that Nolan has already been worth 2.5 wins more than if you just brought a guy up from AAA and put him at third base.
I look at that number as pretty low.
I mean, I think it's pretty low, actually, also.
Because if you're saying, yeah, you could just put anybody and replace him at third base over a course of 31 ball games, and he's only getting, this guy's only 2.5 wins more. I don't buy that.
Yeah, I would agree with you. Nolan with the ground ball to Gene Segura, two outs.
Fans, you want to catch the action when the New York Mets come to town May 13th through the 15th. That's this Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Call 303 Rockies or go online to Rockies.com tickets and get yours today.
We're trying to calculate that great rotation, who the Rockies are going to see. Looks like they'll definitely see Harvey. He went yesterday. Chance you'll see DeGrom.
DeGrom's going tomorrow night against the Dodgers, so
that
it looks
make
at
it Sunday. Parra takes a strike. He had a slow roller on the right side his first time up.
Well, Steven Matz is throwing tonight.
So that's who it'll be. It'll be Harvey, Matz, the left-hander, and DeGrom. At least you won't see the big slugger, Cologne.
First home run.
He just now touched home plate.
when I think they calculated 30 seconds.
The Kentucky Derby went faster than that trek around the bases by Bartello. And that's gonna end the inning. So a strong inning for Archie Bradley. 1-2-3 through the heart of the Rockies order. To the fourth we go. The Rockies are run. The Diamondbacks are run. On Root Sports is brought to you by Subaru. Love, it's what makes a Subaru a Subaru. And by CenturyLink, your link to what's next. Rockies and Diamondbacks knotted up at one apiece, top of the fourth inning. It'll be Paul Goldschmidt, Jake Lamb, Wellington Castillo to face Tyler Chatwood in the fourth. Goldschmidt hit a sac fly in the first to drive in the only Arizona run. It was his 17th RBI. And Goldschmidt takes a strike on the outer third at 91. I'm not reading that one. There's too many CHs in there.
It goes back to how much wood could a woodchuck chuck if a woodchuck could chuck wood.
Very well done.
Now with the granddaughter, you have to, yeah, you have to learn the nursery rhymes again.
She will be impressed. 2-1 on Goldschmidt, who has more walks this year than hits. That too will change. And a good pitch there on 2-1.
When Tyler shook to that pitch.
That thing cut a bunch.
Yes, it did.
May find its way right back here. That's what he went to, yeah. 3-2.
Well, that's hard to get a hitter, a Paul Goldschmidt status, to swing at two pitches consecutive in the same location that are not strikes.
And Goldschmidt has now reached for the 42nd straight time against the Rockies. 42nd, not 42 in a row, folks, 42 games in a row. He already set the club record in April for most walks in that month. So he's not hitting for Paul Goldschmidt average, but he's getting on base.
Just against the Rockies, 479. Against the league this year, 407 on base percentage.
You know, sometimes they're good walks and then they're bad walks. That's a bad walk. It's a 1-1 game. I mean, if Goldschmidt runs into one and hits it 4 miles, it's a 2-1 game. Challenge there.
Yeah, you don't want to put extra guys on base at home. We know that you hit a ball in the gap. Goldschmidt has good wheels.
Plus, he's just 1-for-10 lifetime against Chatwood. Jake Lamb hit into a 4-5-3 double play his first time up. It's 2-0. Now you got a problem. It's 3-0 on Lamb. None of those pitches particularly close. Tony Walters goes out. Chatwood came in about 3.5-1 strikeout to walk ratio, which is terrific.
8 walks and 37 2/3 innings, 27 strikeouts prior to this game. Put the runner in motion. Nope. Now do you if you're Chip Hill? Goldschmidt can run.
Yes.
Over 20 stolen bases a year ago.
He is going, and that's ball four. So back to back walks, an absolute killer. And now you have a guy who's had a fine year. Two best hitters in this Arizona lineup so far this season have been Gene Segura and the guy who's walking to the plate, Wellington Castillo.
Well, we have a moment. We can tell you that live Rockies baseball is back in 2016 with MLB.com at bat on your smartphone or tablet. Stay connected with stats, news, and much, much more. This is a guy that will ambush a first pitch fastball. And That's why they went slot. Smart call, whether it was Tony or Tyler.
Really good look at numbers for Wellington Castillo, the former Cub catcher. One and one.
That ratio has gone down because of the two walks tonight and no strikeouts.
Make a pitch here, 1-2. And he did. He gets a strikeout on Castillo, his first of the night, as Jeff was alluding to. And that'll bring up Chris Herman.
Might have got away with a hanging slider, a backup slider. Sometimes those are the best pitch if you could get away with it at the top of the Subaru strike zone.
Yeah, I'm with you. He ended up getting away with a pitch that was kind of a cement mixer.
But in any event, it's one out.
Herman hit a bouncer to DJ his first time inside. Chappelle saying he wasn't concerned about Herman being out there in right field, so he's a good athlete, better athlete than he's given credit for.
Played over 30 games in the outfield for the Twins. He doesn't get cheated though at the plate.
Yeah, he stepped in the bucket and had a little bit of lift in that swing.
Yeah, spinning on the heels.
So hot, David Peralta. Battling a little bit of a sore forearm. He's sitting down tonight. Yasmani Tomas sitting out. Two guys that typically start for Arizona. The corner outfield spots. That get that get Vic. Carapazza, wow. Yeah.
Just give us the best look on the Subaru Supermo. More on the top of the shoulder. Not as much padding there as there are is on the chest.
You know, umpires are a team themselves. We mentioned that a lot on the air. They take care of one another. They travel together. John Hirschbeck coming down, Bill Welke, the two veterans on that crew, making sure that Carapazza is not trying to be macho and that he's okay.
No, but they have to. Because if it's going to affect him in the game, then they might have to go out, somebody else go behind the plate. But then first and foremost, is your buddy okay?
Outside 2-2. Ground ball to first. That's a great pickup by Reynolds. That's a great pickup by Reynolds. He had a top spin hop, and he gets the out at first.
How many times have we said it this year that, wow, how did he make that play? We've seen him where he stretched and it looked like, oh boy, can he get up? And then this time with the top spin coming right at you on the backhand, goes down, realizing that first base is that option that's the best for him. And that's not an easy pick because it's not a short hop where you can set it in your glove. It's more of the in-between hop.
Just kind of guessing it, where that's going to really come is. Up, aren't you? Here's Owings outside. Chris hit a fly ball to Cargo in the second inning. So two in scoring position, two outs in a 1-1 ball game in the top of the fourth. Walt was asked, and he's been asked a lot about this lately, Mark Reynolds' defense at first. Here's the 1-0. Ground ball to short. Good job by Tyler Chatwood. He walked the first two men. And then he gets the next three. No harm done. We'll go to the bottom of the fourth. Mark Reynolds will lead it off. Fourth inning for the Rockies, and we're talking about Walt Weiss's appreciation for Mark Reynolds. He's really in a situation where he's getting to know him more this spring.
He's tightened up his offense. You know, he's a tougher out than he's been in the past, and that's a credit to him because he's worked on those things. And yeah, athletically and especially defensively, a lot better than I thought also.
Very candid Walt Weiss before the game. There's the one strike offering, and this is lined to center field, but it's right at Owings. One out, five in a row set down by Archie Bradley. Got out of that second inning bases loaded situation with a strike three call on Trevor Story on a pitch that looked like it was well inside.
Archie Bradley in the minor leagues in 84 games, 83 starts. It's 33-19. I mean, he has the big time arm. He just hasn't had enough experience or starts at the major league level to put it together.
And he's got a great fastball and he's using it right now. He's mixing it up, but he's been more of a one pitch guy. Now you hit corners like that in the mid 90s, you're not going to give up a lot. Two strikes on LeMahieu.
It's about the best kind of pitching that you've seen from Archie Bradley. I mean, to dot the corners on the Subaru strike zone, those are, as a hitter, you just kind of tip your cap saying, I don't think you can do it three times.
And he can't. He left that over the plate and shot to the corner. And here's where Herman and his inexperience a little bit. DJ has to dive back to the bag. Stu gave him a stop sign, so it's a double with one out.
Well, seventh double of the season for DJ, but almost like I was saying, he dotted two, and then what's he do? Leaves one up and away from DJ, who has one of the highest average in the major leagues with balls that are away from him. DJ picks up Stu and wisely gets back to the bag because that ball was coming in pretty quick. Herman cut it off pretty fast.
Tony Walters reached on an error by Nick Ahmed in the second inning. And that's outside. That led to the Rockies loading the bases and a great opportunity for Trevor Story. Unfortunately, that controversial called third strike. That pitch previous, the fastball on the block, that looked like that, Jeff Samardzija.
Just Samardzija has been a huge find for the Giants. Not fine.
Well, but both he, yeah, both he and Cueto have pitched really well. The Giants' problem has been when their two veterans have gone, Jake Peavy and Matt Cain. Two and oh on Tony. Three and oh. Chatwood on deck. Catches the zone. It's 3-1. Ryan Rayburn has been a big help to Tony Walters, talking through this rough patch offensively, saying, hey, don't worry about results. It's about process, which is so hard for hitters at any level to realize. Have a good at bat and then move on. And Tony has a good at bat. He walks. It'll be first and second for Chatwood.
Oh, and you're making, especially when you're making that jump from double A to the big leagues, you need to have a mentor, somebody that's helping you out.
Reminder, the day after every Rockies victory, get 50% off your online order at Papa John's. Use the promo code ROCKSWIN at papajohns.com. It's one of those places we know Walt loves, we say it all the time, he loves the slug bunt, especially with a guy who can handle the bat like Chatwood. And he pulled it back, but it was in the zone.
But he hit the bat. Like, I saw those guys charging, and I could have pulled it back. Also, it was a good bunt or a good pitch to lay down a bunt on. Either one. I think Tyler's just kind of kicking himself after that first pitch.
Perfect world. You want to get it to down, the left side.
Yeah,
here.
Right down the third baseline. And if anything, you make the third baseman field it. As hard as Paul Goldschmidt is charging.
Tricky for a base runner, Huey, isn't it? You're the lead runner. You want to get that big secondary, but you can't get back picked if the guy at the plate misses the bunt.
Exactly. So how far do you get off? And you know, if you're DJ, you want to end up somewhere over in this area here. But for Tyler, a good bunt will end up there.
1-1. 2-1. Tyler will stare down Stu Cole.
Now you're back in the slug bunt count. Heck, we've also seen him hit and run here.
Got good speed on with LeMahieu and Walters.
And you've got a lot of open area. Just get the ball down on the ground.
And that misses, so it's 3-1 with Blackman on deck. Rockies and Diamondbacks got both their runs in the first frame. 71 pitches in for Archie Bradley with one out in the fourth. Way inside, and now the bases are loaded for Blackman. So Bradley, with Chadwood giving himself up, did not throw a strike other than the first pitch.
Pitching coach Mike Butcher, longtime Angels pitching coach, must have come out, regroup Archie Bradley.
Here you have the luxury of not only the top of the order, but Huey, third look at Bradley for Charlie Blackman and potentially Trevor Story.
And he's been on base twice, first by the base hit in the first and then walking in the second.
Center fielder, number 19, Charlie
Blackman. A great opportunity for the Rockies to take the lead. LeMahieu doubled, Walters walked, Chatwood walked. Outfield has Herman way off the line and right, and that pitch is away. They pitched him away last time, and I'm looking at the alignment in the outfield. And there's a great look at it. If he hits the ball to left center field, they're pitching him away. He's going to run for days.
They're also pinching the gap in right center field. Doesn't make much sense for the alignment that they're throwing out there the way they're pitching Charlie.
One one bottom of four. Rockies trying to snap a 5-game home losing streak. Coming off a terrific road trip. Charlie lifts this ball to right field. It's going to be deep enough to get LeMahieu home, you would figure. Here comes DJ, and the throw's going to go to third, and Tony Walters beats that, and the Rockies take a 2-1 lead. Sack fly for Blackman, his seventh RBI. Now Herman's got a catcher's arm, and he demonstrated it there. That's pretty
yes,
good throw.
He did. But Charlie, when you go to the plate with the bases loaded, one out, I mean, you're just looking to get something in the air. Now Herman uncorks a very good throw. They're just lucky that the quick hands of Jake Lamb caught that. Watch this pop off the back of Tony Walters on the Subaru Supermo, and Jake Lamb snags it. But Tony wisely kept a foot on the bag. You see it pop up, you think it's going to go to the dugout, and you'll go home.
Story, an RBI double in the first. And a tough called third strike with the bases loaded in the second. Boy, he had some tilt on that swing. No Ted Williams theory. Have some loft in that swing, and Story does.
Because the ball's coming on a downhill plane, you swing up, and then your bat will stay on that path longer and give you a better trajectory, a better chance to hit the baseball.
I'm telling you, I like this matchup. I mean, Story roped that double early. He's been on the heater in his first two at bats. Gets that
he's
rare
also
off speed pitch. It's a changeup.
If he has someone an off speed pitch to him, he's just spitting on it. He's just laying off. He's recognizing that pitch early enough.
The Rockies, and listen, it's 2-1 game, so you give Bradley credit, but they've made him a one pitch guy.
And that eventually catches up with any starting pitcher.
You would think, no matter how hard you throw. 1-1, base hit center field. And this goes all the way to the wall. And it's going to cost him a run. Chatwood around third. He scores, and now the tag on Story will end the inning, but the run counted. Trevor Story hit an absolute missile to center, and then good coaching by Stu Cole to get him to stop, because if he keeps running into the out where the throw went before Chatwood scores, the run would not have counted.
Susan, Stu is his eyes to say the ball is going to beat you. Stop. We'll take the two runs in the 4-1 lead.
Rockies with a three-run bottom of the fourth have a 4-1 lead. Three ribbies tonight for Trevor Story. DJ LeMahieu got that rally going with a one-out double. Tyler Chatwood has been very good so far. Just scored the fourth run. I want to go back. We talked about not only Trevor Story matching up with Bradley, but the inexperience in the outfield, the three infielders playing outfield for Arizona. And this ball, it was a rocket, but Owings has to find a way to keep that in front of him.
Yeah, but did you see the first mistake he made was taking two or three steps in and then had to go back the wrong route instead of staying back, circling around it to cut it off. But he didn't, so Trevor took advantage of it. And then with the help of Stu Cole, they said don't run into that out before that extra run scores.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Stu's passing one guy off and then he's got to get to the next guy. I mean, it's busy for a third base coach, but I'm telling you, that was a huge, huge play, because if Trevor keeps coming, the out may be recorded before Chatwood slides into home. So job well done by Stu Cole. Rockies with a 4-1 lead. That's exactly obviously what they needed, but you kind of felt like they were having good at bats against Archie Bradley, but had broken through.
Right, they hadn't gotten that big hit with runners in scoring position, and who else but Trevor Story comes through again tonight. Three RBIs, 27 on this season.
As the texter said a moment ago, the Diamondback slayer. Gumet takes a strike. Always interested how a pitcher does after running the bases, returning to altitude for Tyler Chatwood. He's got 8-9-1 here in the fifth inning. And he gets a weak ground ball. Story comes and gets it. He throws out his counterpart, one guy.
You hit a double, drive in two runs, and get the first play of this inning. But for Tyler, I was going to see what he did. He waited about 30 seconds, even with the pitching clock that they have now, and in between innings, you have 2:15. He sat in the dugout for about 30 seconds, just making sure that he caught his breath, had a sip of water before he came out, because he knew he's already in the middle of the game and throwing 60-plus pitches. He doesn't need all to fire all those 8 warm-up pitches. He was very smart about it.
And he's quickly ahead of Bradley, two strikes. Rockies up 4-1. Diamondbacks came into this affair 15-18. The Rockies a game south of 500 at 15-16. In a very competitive National League West. Dodgers just underway at home against the Mets. No score there.
Toronto's in the Bay Area. Padres were rained out tonight against the Cubs. They're going to play a split doubleheader on Wednesday.
It's about the only thing that will cool off the Cubs. How about their strategy yesterday against Bryce Harper? 2-2. Now runs full, 3-2 on Archie Bradley.
The strategy not to pitch to him, give him the Bonds treatment.
They gave him the Bonds treatment because twice they walked him with runners at first and second. Ryan Zimmerman left not a village on base. He left a small municipality on base. A major league record 14 left on base by Zimmerman. And Ryan had a ribby also in the game.
But it shows you the strategy worked.
See ya. Strike three. That is the second strikeout for Chatwood. Two gone in the fifth inning, and Gene Segura will come up.
They say, you know what? Not going to happen. I'm not going to let you know who beat me.
You know, Harper a little bit right now like Goldschmidt, the average not what you'd expect of Bryce Harper. It was 265 right around there. He's done a lot of damage when he's put the ball in play. But he's walking so much, his on base percentage like Goldschmidt well over 400. It's the ultimate respect from the opposition. Here's the 0-1 on Segura, and this is lifted to right pretty deep. Cargo looks like he's got room. No, he doesn't. That's gone.
Wow.
Wow, that thing really carried out. Fifth home run for Segura. Cargo deked everybody. 4-2.
And right now, Gene Segura is the best hitter on this team. I know what Paul Goldschmidt has done in the past. He's not having that year, and maybe he will, but right at this moment, Gene Segura is the guy.
Not a bad pitch.
No. And Cargo's playing it like, I'll go back, but then just ran out of real estate.
Brandon Drury takes a strike. He's 0 for 2. Just the third hit for Arizona.
2-0 by that guy.
One of the leading hitters in the league right now. That's high. 1-2. Segura came up in the Angels organization and was traded to Milwaukee. Just missed. Segura came into the game seventh in the league in hitting. He's now reached in a career best 16 straight games. 2-2 on Drury. Goldschmidt on deck. Cuts outside, and now Goldschmidt will come up. That's the third walk allowed. And Steve Foster wants to go to the mound.
Those three walks, he ties a season high in walks for Tyler back on April 29th, the game against these Arizona Diamondbacks.
Again, I know the average says 220 coming in, but this is one of the premier all-around players in the game. By any measurement, he's a top 10 player in baseball. In fact, since the start of 2013, only two guys in the National League have more home runs than Goldschmidt's 94. Anthony Rizzo, 96, Stanton, 98. Base hit. That'll bring up Jake Lamb. Lamb, 4-5-3 double play ball in the first, and then he walked in the fourth.
Both at bats to Lamb here in this game. They tried to cut fastball in and also the slider under the hands.
Going under the hands, and this ball's crushed to right, and now the Diamondbacks have the lead. Wow, that happened fast. Home run, walk, single, three-run home run, and it's 5-4 Arizona. They wanted to go under the hands there. They didn't get it far enough in, and Jake Lamb with his fourth home run of the year.
To me, it kind of goes back to that sequence of pitches to Brandon Drury when you were ahead in the count. You ended up walking him. First pitch to Goldschmidt, base hit. And now, first pitch to Jake Lamb, a home run. It was a no doubter way up into the second deck. Just like that. He worked so hard for the three runs. The bottom half of the fourth inning, get four back here in the top of the fifth.
Castillo at the plate. You know, and it may be written after the game that, well, maybe he was fatigued after running the bases. Didn't seem that way. He got a med quickly. He got Bradley. This is in no man's land, and that's going to drop, and Castillo's going to end up at second base with a bloop double. That is a Coors Field double right there. Broken bat, but it fell in front of the hard charging Charlie Blackmon.
And a big swing from Castillo. Charlie lays out just off his glove on the Subaru Supermo. Didn't have time to secure it in the webbing.
Chatwood was cruising, and now Christian Bergman is up in the Rockies bullpen. One thing about Chatwood, he pitches with his fastball. He's got great movement on it, his cutter. But he hasn't thrown the curveball as much as we saw out on the road.
Not at all. I'm trying to remember when he even had.
I don't know if I've seen one.
One.
Yeah. Even the first pitch, get me over curveball to get a quick strike.
And it could be, and not because he came back home. Maybe he didn't have the feel of it even in the bullpen today. And so he walked out of the pen saying, I can't throw it. I don't have the confidence to do it.
Herman bounces this one foul. Rockies took a 4-1 lead into the top of the fifth. Chatwood got the first two outs, and then Segura hit the opposite field home run. Walk, single, and a 445-foot three-run home run from Jake Lamb. This is in the air to deep right center field. I don't know if Charlie Blackmon can get there. He can't. This will score another run. And heading toward third is Herman. And he's going to have himself a triple. 6-4 Arizona.
Chris Herman must like hitting 0-2. Yesterday, two home runs. This is an 0-2 pitch that he hits for a triple. Slider didn't bite, didn't do much of anything. Short hops the wall in right center field.
Tell you what, Herman, for a guy whose primary spot is catcher, runs pretty well. Chris Owings. And this should get the Rockies to the dugout finally. In the inning, 5 runs for Arizona. They've taken a 6-4 lead. A couple home runs for the D-backs. Brought to you by Southwest Airlines. Book your low fare now at southwest.com. Big turn of events with 2 outs in the top of the 5th inning. The Diamondbacks are up for 5 runs. They had 5 hits in the inning and 4 were extra base hits. 2 home runs, a double and a triple. Now see if the Rockies could counter against Archie Bradley. Cargo, a strikeout and a fly ball to the wall in center. 3-4-5 for the Rockies. Strike. The Rockies have gotten production at the top of the lineup with Blackman and Story. Story has 3 RBIs, and they've gotten traffic at the bottom of the order. The middle 4 hitters, 3, 4, 5, and 6, have not reached. And this one is going to be a base hit off of Goldschmidt. Just was hit in the right spot by Cargo.
And by the time Paul Goldschmidt laid out for that, Gene Segura did not have a chance to call him off. Easier play for the second baseman. He had it. See him pound his glove in frustration. To get it by a guy 6'4" on the Subaru Supermo, but Cargo did.
So that'll bring up Nolan. A strikeout. Ground ball to Gene Segura at second. And there's your in-game box, what we were alluding to. The big boppers in the middle are combined 1-for-9. Time to change that. Nolan slices one to deep right, and it is caught out there by Herman, who is shaded toward the gap. 1 out. Coming up
Next Fan Friday is May 13th, and the first 20,000 fans will receive a Fan Friday tote bag courtesy of MLB Network. Remember, you have to be the first 20,000 fans.
Parra whips that one foul. Ball and a strike. One out, Cargo at first. Rockies trailing 6-4 all of a sudden. You endeavor, Huey, to play less, quote unquote, Coors Field kind of games. And the Rockies believe they can play less with the pitching that they've gotten so far on the road. It's got to, you know, start happening at home. Chatwood came in with the lowest ERA in Major League Baseball on the road, above a 7 at home, and he was cruising. And then saw what happened with two outs. That's a fair ball down the third base line. Cargo to third. Drury will fire it back in, and it's second and third with one out. So the Rockies perhaps a base hit from tying it, as Gerardo Parra, like his good buddy Cargo, going the other way with frequency in 2016.
We've seen tonight Archie Bradley go away from both hitters, the right-handed hitters, the left-handed hitters. Two-seam fastball running away from Parra, stays inside the baseball. You can just see the look in his eyes when he was attacking the ball as he shoots it past Chris Lamb at third base.
So 11 doubles now for Gerardo.
It's a double machine.
Starling Marte has 13 doubles to lead the league. Daniel Murphy with 12, Dexter Fowler with 12. Big at bat here for Mark Reynolds. Rockies trailing 6-4, one out. Going back to what we were talking about, you don't want to always play 9-8 games. It's the last thing you want to do. You want to start playing more conventional games. The Rockies believe they have the pitching to do it. That's a called strike.
You play some of those games that you played out on the road where they've been lower scores, 4-3, 5-4 games.
If you're Mark Reynolds, you got to go in battle mode. You got to get the ball in play.
You have to.
You're conceding the run. But having said all that, you're going to have to win a Coors Field kind of game tonight.
Sometimes that happens. The game will tell you what type of game you need to win. But the one thing you can't do is you can't get freebies. You can't walk guys. That hurt Tyler last inning.
2-2. Again, Bradley's inability to throw anything else for a strike other than his fastball. Reynolds is back in the count.
81 mile an hour curveball last pitch.
He's throwing it for a strike. I don't think he's throwing a changeup for a strike.
I would agree. I'm just going through the pitches in my mind and thinking changeups have been closer than the curveballs, but still not close enough.
Two two.
Well, we've been talking about the outfielders and how they're more of an infielder type. Brandon Drury's average arm for an outfielder slash infielder, accuracy a little bit below Chris Owings, strong arm, but again it goes back to not playing out there enough. We've seen Chris Herman and Wright throw that laser to third base, so you know he has a strong arm. The accuracy, you're just assuming it's going to be average after that throw to third.
Three and two. LeMahieu's on deck.
Well, you have to hunt the fastball, right? I mean, that's what he's had.
Absolutely. 3-2, swung on and missed.
Well, he threw him a changeup.
Threw him a changeup.
Probably the best one he's throwing tonight. Well, that downward action came in the Subaru strike zone out of the hand, looking like it was going to be a strike, but ended up below. Reynolds angry with himself for not making contact and driving at least one run in.
So it'll be left to LeMahieu. He doubled on a two strike count his first time up, or excuse me, his second time up, and we come around to score. That was last inning. Be interesting here. Bradley has LeMahieu at the plate. Not that he wants to put more traffic on base, but you have a young player in Walters on deck who has not been obviously the threat that DJ has been. But that pitch is bounced to deep short and the throw in time, and the Rockies fail to score. Second and third, one out. 6-4 Arizona. We go to the sixth inning. Giant Jenga game going on. Top shelf up there at the rooftop, I guess. Mark Stout, what are you up to?
I am going to give you guys a little injury update on some of the Rockies that are on the road back. So today in Albuquerque, it was an 11 a.m. game. Jorge De La Rosa started, threw 74 pitches, 43 for strikes. You see his numbers. Daniel Descalso led off and played short, went 1-for-3 with a ribby and a walk. Brandon Barnes, by the way, hit second in that game. They won that game. So that's the update on those guys. Jason Mott today threw 25 pitches here at Coors Field. This was earlier. It was a little live BP. He also threw on the road, and after today's outing, I'm pretty sure he is going to hit the road for rehab, because I didn't see him before the game here in the dugout, and usually he is. So that's good news.
Yep, Jason Mott, who's yet to throw a pitch during the regular season. Some tightness, some arm issues coming out of spring training. It'll help that bullpen out when Jason can join it. Two strikes on Nick Ahmed, 8-9-1 in the sixth inning for Arizona. This is how they started in the fifth inning. And Chatwood got Ahmed, he got Archie Bradley, and then the problems arose. Rockies had a 4-1 lead. Segura homered, walk to Drury, base hit to Goldschmidt, and Lamb hit one 4 miles. They weren't done. Castillo would double and Herman would triple.
This is what Tyler did last inning. Brandon Drury worked ahead, then ended up walking him. This will be the last inning for Tyler. He's also due up second next inning. Justin Miller has now replaced Christian Bergman in the bullpen for the Rockies. Tyler at 93 pitches, 59 for strikes.
And again, Tyler was rolling into that fifth inning. Gets a strikeout. Third of the game. Bradley will hit. See where Steven Strasburg reportedly signed a $175 million extension with the Nationals. He's having a great year. Now ball toward DJ. Tough hop. DJ's got some great hands. Two outs.
I saw that. Washington had a walk-off home run tonight by Clint Robinson pinch hitting to beat the Tigers 5-4.
Mets are up 2-0 in Los Angeles on the Dodgers. That's Mats and Kazmir, a couple of lefties. Mets have home runs from Granderson and Plawecki, the catcher, in the absence of Darnell. Segura double. Ground ball to short and the home run over the scoreboard and right. And this ball is well hit, but it's right at Blackman. So 1-2-3, sixth inning. We'll go to the bottom half of inning number six. The Rockies trailing Arizona 6-4. Back in Coors Field, first of three against the Diamondbacks. Thursday will be an off day. And then the Rockies will take on the Mets over the weekend. Arizona was trailing 4-1. They erupted for 5 2-out runs in the top of the fifth inning. So the Rockies on the wrong end of things right now. It'll be Tony Walters. And then Christian Adames is in the on deck circle to hit for Chatwood. Blackman after that. Archie Bradley remains in the game. Seven hits apiece. Outside ball one on Walters. Reached on an error in the second. Walked and scored in the fourth. Tyler is going to be not a happy camper after the game.
Well, because of the five runs he gave up in the fifth, all with two outs.
And again, you know, the contrast. One inning got him because he was pitching well going into that fifth inning. Obviously had the clean sixth inning, but stark contrast his road numbers and his home numbers right now.
Archie Bradley still out there for Arizona. The one thing that he's done tonight, only five times is he not thrown a first pitch strike. 21 and 26. You're not mixing in many breaking pitches. That's one way to make your outing more effective.
Two and two on Walters. That's a fair ball. Lamb's got it, one out.
Your attention. Pinch hitting.
So Christian Adames will pinch hit. Scott Oberg apparently will be next since he's the only one up in the Rockies pen. Darren Holmes looking on.
Arizona has double barrel action in their bullpen.
Never used to see this as much, but now the scouting reports are so vast and deep. When a player comes off the bench to pinch hit, invariably, even in a situation like this where there's nobody on base, the pitching coach will go out and review the scouting report on the guy that's entering the ball game.
That scouting report's 4 hours old. Might have changed.
Might have changed.
Jake Barrett, the right hander, on the left side, Zach Curtis.
There's another first pitch strike. Or maybe not. Rockies trying to snap that five-game home losing streak. 4-8 at home.
We lost the last three to Pittsburgh and two before that to the Dodgers.
And a tragic loss on Sunday against the Dodgers when the Rockies were down, came all the way back, took a three-run lead, and unfortunately couldn't hold it. And a ground ball to second, easy play for Segura.
The Super Suites Conference Center at Coors Field is available for your game day or non-game day meeting. Groups of 25 to 200 will enjoy the views of the city as well as the field from this unique meeting space. A super sweet deal.
Charlie's had a good night. Single and a run scored, a walk and a sac fly in the fourth. Five pitches in. This is lifted to left field, playable on the warning track for Drury, and it's a 1-2-3 sixth inning for Archie Bradley. 6-4 Arizona leading as we go to the seventh. Take a look at our Cooney Letzis look back. The Rockies got this double. They're driving a pair from Trevor Story. He's got a three RBI night. The Rockies had a 4-1 lead. It didn't last long though. In the top of the fifth, Gene Segura with two outs and nobody on, went big fly to right. And then with two on, Jake Lamb on the first pitch of his at bat hit one into the second deck. A three-run home run. The Diamondbacks would tack on another run in a five-run fifth inning. So the Rockies have some catching up to do. Down 6-4. Drew Goodman, Jeff Houston, Mark Stout. Top of the seventh. It'll be 2-3-4 for the Diamondbacks against Scott Oberg.
The ERA for Oberg's coming down. He was scored in his first outing against Pittsburgh, but five scoreless since then. A couple times this year he's gone out and pitched at least two innings, including Thursday in San Francisco.
Ground ball to third. Nolan's got it. One out. So Chatwood goes six innings. He gives up six runs, all of them earned on seven hits, three walks, three strikeouts. He allowed two home runs. Goldschmidt, a sac fly in the first, a walk in the fourth, then a single and a run scored in the fifth.
And for Tyler, his home ERA goes up after allowing the six earned runs. It's 7-8-8 now.
I think you'll often see that a 7.5 run differential between his road ERA, which is the best in baseball, and his home ERA.
Yeah, you're not just talking about one or two starts now. Three starts at home, four on the road.
2-1. I wonder how often this year, and really the last few years, pitchers have thrown a first pitch strike to Paul Goldschmidt. I mean, does it not always? I said this in Arizona. Does right. It always seem like it's 2-0 on Goldschmidt?
I remember when you said that. I was just totally agreed with you because that's what it seems like.
And it was 2-0 a moment ago. Oberg with a couple of strikes. 2-2.
And it doesn't matter if it's nobody on or the bases are loaded. It's still that same way for Goldschmidt.
3-2. Goldschmidt hit 321 last year. He has twice been the runner up to the MVP award, winner in the National League.
Foul ball.
No, it hit off the glove.
Okay.
Another walk. I mean, he's like Bryce Harper. People just don't pitch to him.
Two walks tonight, base hit, and a sac fly. It was off the thumb of Tony Walters. That's what I thought, just from the check swing. I thought it caught the bottom part of the bat for Goldschmidt, but it didn't on the Subaru Supermo.
So here's Lamb. Go ahead, 3-run home run, his last at bat. Hit it 445 feet. Two and oh. It's a 2-0 to Lamb, and that's in there, 2-1. Scott's got good stuff. As you know, his issue is giving up the long ball. What he needs right now is a ground ball. Off the plate. That's a 3-1 count on Lamb.
Most of the time for Scott, when he's gotten in trouble with the long ball, it's been on the curveball. It's been a hanging curveball.
Now back to back walks.
Fifth
Wellington
walk tonight.
Castillo come up. Nope, that's not what the Rockies typically have been doing this year. They've really cut into their number of walks they've had. Led the league the last couple of years in a department you don't want to lead the league, especially when you're playing half your games here.
We had that soundbite earlier from Charlie, the interview he did with Mark, talking about the pitcher's tempo and the rhythm and how quickly they work. You start walking guys, that's when you'll see infielders trying to stay loose, walk around.
Castillo's 2-for-3, gets a breaking ball for a strike, single and a double.
The Rockies pitching on the last road trip was stellar.
Had a 2.78 team ERA over 10 ball games. The pen was great, a 1.78. The starters were real good with a 3.28. On Castillo, and this is going to be a problem. This is going to drop in center field. It's going to score another run, and it's the walks. I mean, Goldschmidt walked and he ends up scoring on a bloop single by Castillo, and now you're down three runs.
What did I talk about a moment ago? When he's been hurt, it's been the curveball, the off speed. This was an off speed that just stayed up.
And people say, well, it's, you know, it's a soft single, it's a bad break, but pitchers will tell you, pitching coaches will tell you, because of how you described it, Huey, the ball being elevated. Now if the ball's down and it's a jam shot, it's going to be on the ground. At this, you know, at Coors Field, with all the ground you have to cover in the outfield,
and it's,
they turn into base hits,
and it's an easier pitch to get to where your hands start in your swing, because you just have to pull them in. You don't have to worry about tilting the body over more to try to get down and reach for a ball. And I think that's why you see, we always talk about a pitch up, how easy it is to hit, because it's the bat that's just staying there with the, on the same plane as the ball.
Want to know on Herman. Tripled on an 0-2 pitch to drive in a run in the fifth. Well, this one's going to be on the Rockies offense to come back. 9 outs to work with. First things first, you got to get out of this frame. 1 out, 2 on. Lamb at second, Castillo at first.
Looking at the swing of Chris Herman reminds me of Matt Stairs somewhat, where Matt was. Remember we used to ask Matt, do you go up there trying to hit a home run? Because most guys would say, no, I'm just trying to hit the ball hard. Matt, what did he say?
Every time
I'm trying to hit a home run.
Trying to hit it to Mars every single time. A strikeout of Herman, 2 outs. That'll bring up Owings. Owings, a fly ball to right and a couple of ground balls in the middle of the diamond. He's 0 for 3. And a hard ground ball, base hit, cargo running to the baseball. Lamb around third, he'll score. Going first to third is Castillo, make it 8-4.
Two walks earlier in this inning come around to score, and now Chris Owings continues to do damage against the Rockies. Owings is a career 245 hitter, but 328 against Colorado.
Nick Ahmed, he's 0 for 3.
Are two former teammates dueling it out.
Yep, for the UConn Huskies.
That was the year they went to the Super Regional. They had George Springer on that team.
Cargo in right center should get there. He will. In the inning, two walks, two hits. Two costly runs, 8-4 Arizona. Here's our Kubota pitching performance. The Rockies had Archie Bradley on the ropes, but he departs with a 6-4 lead. Four runs in six innings. In his return to the big leagues, he walked three, struck out four. And now the Diamondbacks will hand the baseball to Jake Barrett. See the numbers on Barrett this year.
The Rockies have seen him. 4 1/3 innings. He gave up one earned runs, three strikeouts. Last appearance was against Atlanta, 2/3 of an inning. Hard thrower.
You see that note from Jenny? That was the situation last year. That was the most used bullpen in baseball a year ago. And they thought they were going to change that trend with the trade that brought them Shelby Miller and the biggest free agent acquisition in the offseason, Zach Greinke. But those two have not pitched particularly well yet. Story takes a strike. Trevor doubled to drive in a run in the first. Controversial called third strike with the bases loaded in the second. And then a two-run double in the fourth. Rockies down by four all of a sudden.
Early in the game just felt like it's kind of cruising along. You had the game and you're up 4-1 and then trying to get that elusive out in the fifth. Five runs later you're down.
And another called strike on a pitch in. One ball, two strikes.
And that third pitch on the Subaru strike zone, that's where that pitch was when he was called out on that strike. Strikeout in the second, same spot.
Story has driven in 15 runs in seven games against Arizona this year. He hit over 300 on the road trip, including a couple of home runs. This is a pop up on the right side. Segura and Goldschmidt. Goldschmidt makes the catch. One out. That'll bring up cargo.
Number five, Carlos Gonzalez.
A Cargo singled his last time up off the glove of Goldschmidt. 1-for-3. The number of hits that Cargo has gotten recently to left field, the Giants stopped shifting against Cargo, or not as dramatically so. The Diamondbacks have the typical shift on.
Obviously, they haven't, or they're not paying attention to the hits by direction for Cargo, because this is how they played them in the six previous games.
1-2. Barrett strikes out Gonzalez, two outs.
All three pitches were off speed, two sliders and a changeup. Three that he swung at. This was a fork change at 88 miles an hour.
Nolan's 0-for-3, strikeout, ground out, a line drive to deep right. Hitting just under 400 his last 12 games.
Another guy before the game that Chip Hale was praising. He's watching Nolan from the opposing dugout.
Well, that's
pretty much everywhere we go now.
That's wherever we go. Everybody's singing his praises, and well they should. Seven unanswered runs by Arizona. Two outs, nobody on in the seventh. That's foul.
Barrett grew up in the Phoenix area, Desert Ridge High School, and also to ASU, now pitching for the Diamondbacks. Well, how about that for Nolan? Turns on a fastball about 97 miles an hour, and then they go with the slider in a perfect location, the fourth pitch on the Subaru strike zone. He fouls it off. And that's a pitcher's pitch at 87, covering both sides of the plate at varying speeds.
Not easy to do.
Great ones can do it better than the average human or average ball player.
Going to be a 1-2-3 inning for Barrett. Segura's got it, and we'll go to the eighth inning. The Rockies trailing 8-4 in their return home.
down 8-4, seven unanswered runs by the Arizona Diamondbacks. What a flashback, and show you something that happened significant in baseball on this day in 2010. It was Mother's Day. You may remember Dallas Braden, who was 26-36 in his 5 years in the bigs, threw a perfect game on Mother's Day against the Rays. I believe his grandmother was there too. 19th perfect game in MLB history. And guess what? Dallas Braden, who now works for ESPN and talks baseball nationally, tomorrow for our Twitter takeover, Toyota Talk Twitter takeover, he is going to be our special guest. He'll give us a little national perspective on the Toyota Talk takeover. Use that hashtag tomorrow during the game. That'll be cool, guys.
Yeah, absolutely. We look forward to that. Mark, thank you. Two-strike count. And Scott Oberg continues on. It's Phil Gosselin at the plate, pinch hitting. Ground ball to Nolan. What a tough play. Now can he get Gosselin on the hop? Out at first base. The old two-hop throw.
We saw two of these type of plays in Arizona against the Diamondbacks, both in the same inning. Now he does one here that I'm not sure we've seen before, where he goes back, he just throws it as he's falling away from first, two hopper.
The only problem is he's safe.
Yeah, they're going to review this one. But to even make it this close where you're within 5 feet of first base, allowing the first baseman Mark Reynolds to stretch. He just couldn't stretch out going towards the ball. He had to wait for the runner to cross and try to catch it in foul territory.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable that he made it that close. See the safe call, so it'll be an infield hit despite that great effort by Nolan.
Foot on the bag, then the ball in the glove.
Gene Segura doubling a home run, 2-for-4 tonight. 8-4 Arizona. That was the 10th hit for the Diamondbacks. Rockies have been locked in at 7 for a while now. Double play ball.
Miss the action when the New York Yankees make a rare appearance here at Coors Field on June 14th and 15th. Get your tickets today to see the New York Yankees.
Brandon Drury at the plate. He's 0-for-3 and a walk. He scored in the fifth inning.
Drury, left field, second base, third base.
Slicing foul out of play. Well, they had to go into slight desperation mode when A.J. Pollock was lost in all likelihood for the year with the broken elbow. They lost their center fielder and an all-star. So Owings, who's going to platoon in the middle infield, there's going to be a three-man rotation with Segura, Owings, and Ahmed. He went out the center field. They're an imperfect team defensively. Nolan's got that one. And that ends the inning. But right now, they have an 8-4 lead. The Rockies are running out of outs on offense. We'll go to the bottom of the eighth. Parra will lead it off. Colorado Rockies baseball on Root Sports is brought to you by Southwest Airlines. Book your low fare now at southwest.com. And by Wells Fargo. Wells Fargo customers get your 2-for-1 Rockies club level tickets by visiting wellsfargo.com/Rockies. Well, it was a pleasant night in the middle innings. Not so pleasant now. The Rockies were up 4-1. They gave up 5 at the top of the fifth. And a couple more runs off Scott Oberg. And it is 8-4. Arizona. The Rockies will try to get things going to the bottom of the eighth with Gerardo Parra. He doubled in the fifth inning. It's the last Rockies base runner. Rockies had a chance, you remember, in the fifth inning. They had runners at second and third after the Parra double because Cargo had singled. One man out, but Mark Reynolds struck out and DJ LeMahieu grounded out to end that threat.
Well, they get the longtime eighth inning man and Tyler Clippard.
Fastball changeup. That's what you're going to get with Clippard. He's a guy, as he throws a changeup there, that'll not only double up on his changeup, he'll triple up on the changeup.
Quadruple on the changeup. He's only given up one run in his 9 innings of career relief at Coors Field.
Well, time to change that.
That's right.
Ball and a strike on Parra. This ball is lathered to left center field and it is over the head of Drury. And that is double number 12 for Gerardo Parra. His second tonight. Good start to the inning.
It is, and it's something he's familiar with against these Arizona Diamondbacks. Already had a 3-double game earlier this year. Last time it was a double down the line. This time it's a double over the left fielder, Brandon Drury's head.
Mark Reynolds 0 for 3. Outside, ball one. Rockies 5-1 against Arizona this year. And that's fouled off.
Rockies just 1-for-7 tonight with runners in scoring position.
Clippard steps off.
Well, he didn't want to throw to second base. Segura put the daylight play on. As an infielder, you also have to know what pitch is going to be thrown. I'll tell you why in a moment.
Taking off for third is Parra. He's got to be safe. He's out. Man, that's terrible.
It's not a smart play at all.
you're down by four runs. I don't get that at all.
A couple times this year we've seen Parra try to steal third base and has been thrown out. That's. He has movement going, but it's an easy throw, short throw for the catcher. But down by four, doesn't matter. You have to make sure that you're 100% safe. It can't even be 99.
I don't get that. 2-2 on Reynolds. In the air to left field, and it's going to drop in front of Drury.
Now think about this.
Yeah, I mean, you, listen, when you're down by four runs, you're going to have to hit your way back in. Not a one run game where that 90 feet means a whole lot. DJ coming up with one out. Who wants tacos? Fans, follow at @RootSports_RM on Twitter to receive alerts for the Rockies taco special when the Rockies score seven or more. Balk on Clippard.
That was the knee flinch by Tyler Clippard. He knew it, didn't argue at all. Still kind of shaking my head at that attempted steal at third base. And if you're wondering, that's not a call that the manager would make down by four in the bottom of the eighth inning. That
absolutely
was all on
absolutely not
Gerardo.
And another base hit. Reynolds will stop at third. Play along at home with the woulda, coulda, shoulda. Tony Walter's coming up. Ryan Rayburn on deck to hit the pitcher spot.
Nobody up for Arizona.
Well, I think they look at this. You know, the veteran guy like Clippard has had so much success in his career. You know, when a closer gets in trouble, you don't see a parachute, especially early, because it's his inning. And Chip Hale looks at the eighth inning, and it's Tyler Clippard's inning. We're not matching up. It's his inning.
For a guy that has over 500 appearances at the major league level, he reached that milestone, number 500, against the Rockies back on May 1st. You're going to let him do his thing in this inning.
Swung on and missed, 0-1. Three straight hits, double, single, single here in the bottom of the eighth inning. Rockies down 8-4.
Now the left-hander, Andrew Chafin, is warming up for the D-backs.
Maybe if he gets to the top of the lineup, Blackman. Two of the next three after that for the Rockies are left-handed. Blackman after Story, you have Cargo. Walters in battle mode now, down 0-2.
This is the count that Clipper will throw the change up to get you to reach for it.
Set up off the plate away. Tony's got two outs, and it'll be left to Ryan Rayburn.
That's exactly the pitch he went to after Tony to foul a fastball off 0-2. Change up from Tyler.
Number six, Ryan Rayburn.
And scouting report coming in with Mike Butcher. Mike Butcher's talking at the mound. We'll tell you a little bit more about Ryan Rayburn. Out of high school, though he was drafted out of high school, signed with University of Florida. He was a guy who was in the mid-90s in high school on the mound, too. And in Florida, didn't work out after a year there, so he transferred to a junior college. He did some closing in junior college baseball and went in the fifth round and eventually got moved to second base, which kind of opened up a ladder to the big leagues because he kept hitting and he could always hit. He's had
That's
a fine big
said.
League career.
Always, if you have that one skill to open your eyes to allow you to maybe do something else, and that's what Ryan did.
In the dirt.
Except for he had two. He could throw hard and hit.
Yep. Remember Ryan Sheely?
Yes.
He played with Ryan at Florida for a little bit. First and third, two outs. 1-0. And it's down the line, foul. Getting down quickly was Reynolds.
Really nowhere to go as a base runner. End up after your secondary lead, maybe 80, 78 feet away. And then the ball is hooking on you.
Change the eye level with the fastball, and it's 1-2.
For Tyler, he can achieve that goal of the change in the eye level because the changeup is always down. Then the fastball comes up. It appears to be 95 to a hitter.
Two and two on Rayburn. Rockies won yesterday in San Francisco 2-0. It was their fourth shutout of the year. They had only four shutouts all of 2015. Tonight they've given up 8. 2-2.
Like that pitch back. He knows that he had to chance to hit that one in the seats.
This ball's well hit to right field, but it's going to die shy of the track in the glove of Chris Hermans. The Rockies get three hits but do not score. A frustrating eighth inning. 8-4 Arizona.
The top of the ninth. We're out in center field, second, ready for the Toyota postgame show. Jenny Kavanaugh with Corey Sullivan and Ryan Spielberg. It's not the return the Rockies were hoping for here at Coors Field.
No, it's definitely not Tyler Chatwood's best performance. Just too many free passes by all the pitchers so far.
Well, and when you've only won one of your last six games at home, you have to be smarter in certain situations. Base running, number one for me.
Yeah, we'll break down pitching and the late inning offense coming up on the Toyota postgame show. For now, we'll send it back to Drew and Jeff.
All right, Jenny, thank you. In the top of the ninth inning, Justin Miller will take the baseball for the Rockies. He'll face Goldschmidt, Lamb, and Castillo with the score 8-4. Well, I want to talk a little bit about the Hartford Yard Goats. We like to talk about them every day. They won again today, by the way, and they haven't played a home game yet. Their top three starters, listen to this. Their top four starters. Kyle Freeland's 4-1 with a 1.42 ERA. Herman Marquez is 3-1 with a 1.03 ERA.
Eastern League pitcher of the week last week.
Boy, had no hitter going into the eighth inning the other day. Here's Goldschmidt. Fouled off. Harrison Musgrave, who won today with seven strong innings, is 5-0 with a 1.30 ERA. Zach Gemiola is 3-0 with a 2.34 ERA.
And they just received Tyler Anderson today, who is coming off the DL.
That is some kind of team. David Dahl, one of the Rockies' top prospects, one of the top prospects in the game, hitting 288 with an Eastern League leading 9 home runs. He also has 9 doubles.
Yeah,
he's 11 out of 13 stealing bases also.
In a few more weeks, they'll be able to play in their own ballpark.
This ball is hit to deep right center. Cargo is going to watch it hit off the top of the wall. And Goldschmidt.
How strong is he?
Yeah, I mean, he basically was out on his front side and almost hit that thing out. So a double for Goldschmidt, his second hit. He has 2 walks and a sack fly. He's had a perfect night.
Reach out. And just pepper the ball off the fence in right center field. I'm halfway up. Where the head followed the barrel to the baseball.
All inside.
So with that win tonight by Hartford, they're 22-8.
They're the double A version of the Cubs. Brendan Rodgers, Asheville won today 9-3. Brendan Rodgers had a couple more hits. He's hitting 363 in the Sally League. Ball's hit a long way to right, and it's off the top of the wall and right. It's coming all the way back to the infield. Goldschmidt scoring easily and rounding third and holding with a triple is Lamb. It is 9-4. It's turned ugly at 20th at Blake. In a game the Rockies led 4-1 going to the fifth inning. Now 9-4 Arizona.
Three RBIs on the evening for Jake Lamb. Four RBIs, excuse me. Came with that in an eyelash of making it five with a foot short shy of the wall.
Outside on Castillo. So Goldschmidt, sack fly, a walk, a single and a run scored, a walk and a run scored, double and a run scored, and then Lamb behind him, 4-5-3 double play, then a walk, three run home run, walk and a run scored, and a triple and an RBI. Nobody out, the infield's in. 1-0 on Castillo. Fouled off.
Jake Lamb with the home run and the triple. 12 out of his last 18 hits have been extra base hits.
And this is line to center field. And here's Charlie's throw to the plate. It's offline. A run batted in for Castillo, and Arizona's hit double figures. They're up 10-4. Second ribby of the night for Castillo. Rockies pen outstanding on the trip. They've given up four runs in two innings. Oberg gave up two in two innings, and now Miller has given up two with one out in the ninth. Chris Herman at the plate. Tripled in a run in the five-run fifth for the Diamondbacks. Well, the Rockies are staring at a 4-9 start at Coors Field. Hard to believe.
Who would have thought that? Talk about reestablishing some dominance here. It's still early, but that's not the start when you're talking about one of your offseason goals is that as a team to come out and be five games under 500 at home.
Two and one. And a foul tip, two and two. It's full 3-2. Caught looking, two outs, and Chris Owens will take his turn.
Caught the corner in to Herman. I think he was expecting something else. Doesn't matter, Justin Miller. It's called strike three.
Owens is 1-for-4, singled in a run in the seventh. And a ground ball to first. Reynolds has it, and that's the end of the inning. So we'll go to the bottom of the ninth inning. Two more runs tacked on by the Diamondbacks. They're up 10-4.
Top of the order to face Randall Delgado here in the bottom of the ninth inning. Here's our CenturyLink link to what's next tomorrow evening. Ruby De La Rosa will get the baseball for Arizona. Chris Russin will make his third start for the Rockies this year. And hopefully Chris can come up with one of those gems he had last year at Coors Field. Threw two complete games at Coors Field last season. We're on the air at 6 o'clock right here on Root Sports with our pregame show. So here we go in the bottom of the ninth inning. Charlie Blackman, single, walk, sack fly, and a deep drive to left.
19 innings for Delgado. That's tied for third as far as innings go in the National League.
Charlie with the base hit earlier has a 7-game hitting streak going. Charlie hit above 340 on the road trip. 2-1. Career 331 hitter here at Coors Field. And this ball's loud, but it's right at Herman. Cannot hit it any harder.
No, you can't. It was loud. Herman just made two steps to his left to catch the sinking line drive.
Trevor Story has driven in 3 of the 4 runs for the Rockies tonight. Doubled in the first, and that scored Blackman. Then he doubled in 2 of the 4.
Rockies have been out hit 12 to 10. Story takes a strike. When they've been out hit this year, they are 1-11. Well, she's got another few hours to stay up. Save some of that popcorn for tomorrow.
I like the energy, though.
I don't know how much mom and dad are going to like the energy in a little bit.
It'll go away in the car.
Out before they get the highway, huh?
You know how car rides are with kids.
How car rides are with me.
Even when you're driving.
Easy. Strike three. Two outs. Well, you sat next to me on a million flights now. Mm-hmm. I can sleep anywhere.
Yes, you can.
Cargo is 1-4. Single back in the fifth inning. On the frustration scale, where's this potential loss?
I think it's up there. I mean, you had Tyler coming off his performance on the road. There's another hit to the opposite field for Cargo.
It's going to be a double. The major league leader in hits to left field.
We've seen him. Three or four off the end of the bat for Cargo that stay fair. Interference is called by the DJ Rayburn, the third base umpire. But just to finish that thought, I think it's got to be up there a little bit. Yeah, Tyler, you're up 4-1 in this ball game. You have Archie Bradley who's making a spot start. Just couldn't put any more on the board after that. The base running play in the eighth inning too. That's just can't happen.
Yeah, because you don't know how that inning's going to go.
Right. I mean, you get three hits and no runs out of it.
And even after the five-run uprising by Arizona, it's a 6-4 game in the middle innings. But it just. Kept getting further and further away from the Rockies. And that's a called strike. It's 0-2 on Arenado. Mike Nolan has been pitched very well tonight because they painted him. It's 0-4. He's taken more
and they thrown
called strikes tonight because they're right on the, typically they were right on the outer edge of the plate, the black of the outside corner.
And if he's gone up there with the game plan of taking the first pitch, they've thrown that first pitch strike.
All that means is somebody's going to pay shortly.
Oh, yeah. You know they will.
Time for the major league lead in home runs with Robinson Cano of Seattle. One and two on Nolan. Now Nolan 25. How about this stat? The Rockies lead Major League Baseball 23 home runs and 61 RBIs from players 25 and younger. Step to the middle of the carpet. Nolan Arenado and Trevor Story.
When you talk about players and when they start to reach their prime, some people don't think it's till you're 27, 28. So now these guys are doing it well before what the quote unquote norm might be.
And they look like they're going to be able to sustain it for a while. 2-2. Yeah, the general thinking, you well know, Huey, from your days not only as a player but as a as an instructor in the Cubs organization, is 26-32 is thought to be, and the statistics usually bear this out, your prime.
Well, because you have enough at bats to know what type of hitter you are or how many innings you've thrown collectively, whether it's the minor leagues and some in the big leagues, wherever it is. So now you know what that baseline is.
2-2. Well, a good example of it is Chad Bettis. Chad has become a real solid, solid big league pitcher. And there's a tremendous upside, I think, with Chad. And he's now 27. There's a process. Now, he was a college draft pick. Starter, reliever, back to starting where he's most comfortable. And now he's figured it out. Talking to Adam Ottavino. Another guy took a while to figure out. Back up the middle, and it's redirected. This should be a hit. So the Rockies get the infield hit for Nolan, from Nolan, and that'll bring up Parra.
Never apologize for a hit that Nolan won't hear. But for Delgado, he reached behind his back to try to snag it. That allowed this ball to be redirected, because if he doesn't make the play, Gene Segura, with his positioning, more than likely would make the 4-3 put out. For Nolan, average up to 317.
Pair of doubles for Gerardo tonight, 2-for-4. Rockies with a dozen hits, matching what Arizona has put forth. Two balls and no strikes. Parra doubled down the third baseline and a double to left center field. With the big lead, Arizona's not playing quote unquote no doubles, guarding the line, playing deeper in the outfield. They're playing straight up defense in the infield and outfield with the 6-run advantage.
And they're also not holding Nolan on at first with Goldschmidt.
A base hit left center field. Cargo will score. Nolan goes first to third. Three hit night for Parra. And it's 10-5.
As long as you haven't gotten to that 27 out yet, you still have a chance. And the Rockies aren't laying down right now. RBI single for Gerardo, driving in Cargo.
That'll bring up Mark Reynolds. Singled last inning, his first knock of the ball game, 1-for-4.
Hudson has had to get up for the Arizona Diamondbacks in their bullpen.
And that bounces up there.
Thank you.
ball and a strike on Reynolds. Side 2-2. Rockies came into the game 12-10 against the National League West. Through 22 games last year, they were 7-15. Scoring runs home and road, obviously more so on the road. We know what's gone on at home so far, averaging 5.7 runs inside the division, which you play against the vaunted pitching staffs typically in this division and ballparks like AT&T in San Diego. The Rockies haven't played at Dodger Stadium yet. It's hard to score close to 6 runs a game, but they're doing that so far, but they're on the wrong end tonight. 10-5, 2 outs in the ninth. And Reynolds strikes out to end the ball game. So the Rockies come home and they fall 10-5 to Arizona. They've now lost 6 consecutive games at Coors Field, and they fall to 15-17. The Diamondbacks improve to 16-18. They've won 4 straight. Bradley gets the victory, his first major league win since last April. And Chatwood takes the loss. He is now 4-3. Our Jimmy John's delivery of the game. Jake Lamb with the Rockies ahead 4-2. 2 men on. First pitch from Chatwood. He hits into the second deck 445 feet away. And that put Arizona in front 5-4. And they go on to produce a 10-5 victory, the first out of 3 here at Coors Field between Colorado and Arizona. Let's get to our center field studio, if you will. Here's Jenny and the gang. Jenny, it's all yours.
All right, Drew, thanks so much. Looks like the Diamondbacks had some pent-up anger against the Rockies, and they let it fly tonight at Coors Field. Coming up, we'll break down the pitching and woes of the late inning offense. We'll be right back.